King of the universe, who sanctified us with his commandments and commanded us to engross ourselves in the words of the Torah. Baruch atah Yehovah Eloheinu, melech haolam asher kishanu b'mitzvotav v'tzivanu la'asak b'dvarei Torah. Please, Yehovah, make the Torah's words sweet in my mouth, in the mouth of all your people, the house of Israel. May we, your children, all of Israel, know your name in the name of your Messiah, Yeshua. And may we study your Torah simply because it is good. Blessed are you, Yehovah, who gave us the Torah of truth. Remain standing as we read from the Torah portion, Genesis chapter 18, 16 through 19, and then also from Haggai 1, 5 through 7, and then Hebrews chapter 2, 11 through 13. The men set out from there and looked over toward Sodom, and Abraham went with them to see them on their way. And Adonai said, "Should I hide from Abraham what I'm about to do? Inasmuch as Abraham is sure to become a great and strong nation, and all the nations of the earth will be blessed by him. For I have made myself known to him so that he will give orders to his children and to his household after him to give the way of Adonai and to do what is right and just, so that Adonai may bring about for Abraham what he has promised him."
Vayakumu misham chanashim vayishkifu alfene sedom Abraham cholek imam el shalcham Yehovah amer ham kaseh ani me Abraham asher ani ose veAbraham hayo hiche el goy gadol veatzum vinibirku bo kol goyei haaretz ki yaditu el ma'an asher tzave et banayu ואת ביתו אחריו ושמרו דרך יהוה לעושת צדקך ומשפט אל מען חבי יהוה על אברהם את אשר דיבר אליו.
Haggai 1, 5 through 7. Therefore, here is what Adonai Sevaot says. Think about your life. You sow much, but bring in little. You eat, but aren't satisfied. You drink, but never have enough. You clothe yourselves, but no one is warm.
What?
And he who works for a living earns wages that are put in a bag full of holes. Here is what Adonai Sevaot says. Think about your life.
Vata koamar Yehovah, Tzabaot simu el babkem al darkei kem. Zratem harbe vechabe ma'at ako vein sab, achshato vein el shakra, labosh vein el chom lo, vacham tak. Taker mitz taker el tzro nakub kom omar Yehovah tzabaot simu labkem al dar kekem.
Hebrews 2, 11 through 13. For both Yeshua, who sets people apart for God, and the ones being set apart have a common origin. This is why he is not ashamed to call them brothers when he says, "I will proclaim your name to my brothers. In the midst of the congregation, I will sing your praise. Also, I will put my trust in him." And then it goes on. Here I am, along with the children of God has given me.
Ki gamcha kadesh, gamcham kudashim kulam me'achad chemeval ken lo bosh mikro lachem achim lemor asavram shimaak leachai betok kachal achalala v'omer v'yikiluti lo v'od hine anoki v'chayladi asher natan li Yehovah.
Blessed are you, Yehovah, our God, King of the universe, who gave us the Torah of truth, that everlasting life from our midst. And blessed art thou, O Yehovah, the giver of the Torah.
Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam, asher natan lanu Torat emet v'chayim alam nita betachanu. Baruch atah Adonai noten haTorah.
Amen. Lift both your hands and say with me, Lord, let me hate sin as mercilessly as I judge it in others. Amen. Give the Lord a shout of praise. Hallelujah. You can be seated in his presence. We're looking at the call of holiness. We are in lesson 3 of the call of holiness. I told you it might be 25 years, 30 years, 10 years until we're done talking about holiness. Well, at least for some of you, it will be until the Lord returns. Amen. The call of holiness is important because we need to understand where he wants us to be, where he wants us to go. And if we truly want a revival in our lives, then we have to rearrange our lives. He does not give us revival the way we are. He gives us the revival the way he wants us to be. And if we are sincerely wanting, desiring, kneeling before him, asking him, he will do and cause a great revival in this place. And I believe that we as God's people, we as Lion of Judah, need a revival. If I was looking at this Torah portion, we were reading the story of Abraham and then Sodom and Gomorrah, and I'm not going to be focusing on Sodom and Gomorrah, but I am focusing on what Yehovah wanted, and he was going to go and destroy a city that had turned their back on him. And we find he was struggling whether to tell Abraham or not, and he decided to tell Abraham, and so Abraham goes down, and of course we know the sequence. If there's 50, will you save the city? If there's 40, and he goes on down, and he goes on down, because he knows his odds are not good, and he tries to get him as low as possible, because he knows that what God wants and what God will do is save a people if there are some that are righteous. Not all of us need to want revival, just one, just two, maybe five. And if we are one who want revival and pray and seek his face, then I believe that God will give us all revival. So I looked at this Torah portion, trying to match it up with my series on holiness, and I decided to call this Consider Your Ways, or the Complete Jewish Bible translates it, Think About Your Life. You know, a lot of times we have arrived now. This is going, I'll be 60 next year. And there's probably so many times I should have stopped and considered. Stopped and thought. Because one day goes into the next and one month goes into another. And here we are. We are arriving at almost 2020. Who would have thought it? Right? And then you look back and you haven't realized maybe there were some paths, some things, something maybe could have been changed or altered, could have said something, could have been quiet about something, could have made a stamp or made a standard. And so we got to really realize that if we're going to be holy, it means that you have to consider your ways, according to Haggai. In 1 Peter 1:16, Romans 8:29, which seems to be our kind of staple scripture, it says, since the Tanakh says, you are to be holy because I am holy. And Romans 8:29 says, because those whom he knew in advance, he also determined in advance, would be conformed to the pattern of his son so that we might be firstborn among brothers. We started out with an introduction about holiness. We talked 2 weeks ago about sin, because in order to understand holiness, you have to understand sin. And I said that we are not, in this day and age, really understanding sin. We don't. Because we watch things and hear things and do things and say things. We're not paying attention anymore. To understand holiness is to understand what unholiness does. How it steals, how it kills, how it destroys. To understand holiness. So we're going to spend, again, a couple weeks on unholiness or what sin does before we move into the power of holiness, because unless you understand that, you'll never understand holiness. There's a lot of people in the world that believe they understand holiness, and they don't. A lot of people believe that they understand salvation, and they don't. Well, it's just a matter of being good. No, it's not. So we talked about the three different situations or how and what unholiness does or what sin does. And we, number one was sin does not satisfy. We went through that. I'm not going to, you know, go over that again, because you can have it on YouTube. You can have it on our site. Sin does not satisfy. Number two, we talked about that sin leads to more sins. And that is true. And I don't care how many times we argue about that. It does lead. Try one thing, it'll lead to something else, and lead to something else, and lead to something else. Number three, sin leads to worse sins. What seems to be very easy or not so bad leads to something that could be really bad. And now we're going to look at number four. I'll spend most of my time on number four today, and then we'll move to number five, but we're only doing two today. And so when we look at this one, because this one is very important, this one is very powerful, this one we need to get. Because even though one and two and three are important, we know that number four, sin enslaves. And there's not one of us that want to be a slave. No one wants to be a slave. Slaves have no freedom. Slaves have no rights. Slaves live to do the will of someone else. understand this. Sin becomes your master. Slaves have no future, no ability to determine their lot in life. Slaves have no hope unless someone can liberate them. I went and saw, and I just recommend, I went and saw Harriet. Excellent movie. Go watch Harriet. The Moses of that day. Someone had to liberate them. Someone had to be moved. And the movie shows, actually, that she was moved by God. She listened to God. She heard God. She moved when God told her to move. And she went in different directions when God told her to go in different directions to make sure that the people that were chasing her would not get her and those that she was saving. And it reminded me then of my sermon that I was preaching, because no one wants to be a slave. Slaves have no freedom, no rights, until someone can liberate them. And I want you to know, Yeshua is the Son of God and has liberated us. Yeshua. Slavery is misery, especially when the master is harsh, selfish, insensitive, cruel, and very powerful. And though we know that the enemy is like a roaring lion, because we look in his perspective and not God's, he can become very harsh and very selfish and very insensitive, very cruel and powerful. But we do know this about sin. Sin is the same way. Sin doesn't care about how much money you make. Sin doesn't care in what house you live in. Sin doesn't care what you're going through or what you haven't gone through. Sin doesn't frankly care. It just wants you. And when it gets you, it will cause you to be a slave to it. When you think of slavery, I want you to think of Satan. Did you hear me? We are living in a day and age where we are not speaking up about sin. Therefore, sin has power to enslave. Sin shackles and is easy to step into. How many has ever stepped into sin easily, but so hard to step out of? Oh, we can just step right on in it, and we just seem like, and there it is, and whoops, there I am. But to get out of that thing, that is a struggle. That is hard. Freedom is gone in a moment when we allow sin to come. This is a sermon that's not only for us who are old folk, it's for those who are young. Because they need to know that life is not life that is going to offer them everything that's wonderful, because sin is there to try to gravitate them back into slavery. And they need to know that if the Son has set them free, then they are free indeed, because Yeshua is the Son of God. How does this principle of sin work? Well, it works that before you got entangled with a specific sin or habit, you were free. Right? Listen, you're not bound to nicotine until you start it. You're not bound to alcohol until you drink it. You're not bound to drugs until you smoke it. You're not bound to sexual sins until you engage in it. You're not bound to pornography until you watch it. Right? You're not born with a pack of cigarettes in your diaper. You're not born with drugs coming out. Listen, you are free. You are free as free can be, and it's only the environment and the way that we look and the way that we go and who we come in contact with and who our friends are and what our eyes are open to and who we listen to that allows that sin to come and enslave us. And it's hard to break. We sit here as people, church people, loving God with everything that we have, but residue of sin in our lives. Before you're entangled, you're free. Why is it that we forget about how freedom feels? Now you are under this power of someone. You are under this power of something else, but you didn't have to be enslaved. This is not a sermon of condemnation. This is a sermon to let you know that God did not want you to remain where you are. Because in Romans that I read in the very beginning, he has brought you to a place where you will be conformed to the pattern of his son. He wants you to be free, and he who the son sets free is free indeed. Just remember what it feels like to be free. Question that we need to ask ourselves is this: what has brought us to the place that we can't live without it? There's something in our lives. For example, there's a lot of examples that I could use, but one of the greatest examples is exactly what you brought with you today. Your phone. Your phone. Now, there's nothing bad about the phone. You know, there's not a demon sitting on your phone unless you tuned him in to be on your phone. But I'm thankful for the phone. I'm thankful that I can take a phone. I'm thankful that on a in a store I can answer a phone. I'm thankful that you are at my fingertips. I'm at your fingertips. I don't have to wait and go home and pull that thing from the wall. Because how many times did you accidentally move it and it flung? But that phone. Do you know how you know when that phone is not in a position where it has begun to enslave you? When you worry about where it is, when you can't leave the house without it, when you are upset when you thought you lost it, and when you want to kill someone who broke it, you're enslaved. When you're sitting across the table in Thanksgiving and you cannot put it down. Oh, I can put it down, but across the room. Because I still need to hear the bing bing in case someone calls. This is the same thing in Africa. We used to go to Africa for 20 some years. No one had a phone. Now they will get up. They will answer. They will talk on the phone while I'm preaching. Hello. I'm like, what is wrong with you people? You're becoming too much like us. It's like, you know, what's going to happen? Now, I could give you other examples. Social media could go on down the line. But what, the question is, then what has brought you to the place that you can't live without it? What has worked its way into your life? What has enslaved you? If you don't think that your phone or anything like that has enslaved you, do without it for just a little while and see how it makes you feel. See how it alters your brain. See how it alters your whole breathing system. See how it makes you nervous. You know, for instance, if you're someone who, I'm not bound by food, well, then stop eating. And here's the thing about stopping to eat. You'll have to go to bed. And if your body says you better go to bed or go do something, that means that you're enslaved to it because you have to preoccupy it because you will think about it. I want you to understand that we are altering our children's brains by allowing them to do some things that has already set the tone for enslavement. Look at your own daily routine and give it some careful thought. That's your homework for this for this week. Go home, think about it, sit down, look at your daily routine, and figure out what is driving you and what you cannot live without. Because the one thing that you should not be able to live without is him. Because he is the Son of God. Everything else doesn't matter. What rules your life? Whose power are you under? Do you live to do the will of Yehovah, or are you compelled to do the will of someone or something else? Oh, I wish that which we are enslaved to would be more like we are enslaved to Yehovah. We can't miss the kingdom. We can't miss our prayer time. We can't miss our assembly. We can't miss our reading our Bible. We can't. If I miss it, there's something that happens within me because I'm enslaved to him. But none of us are like that most of the time. To be bound by anyone or anything other than Yehovah is totally unacceptable. Turn to someone and say, that's totally unacceptable. Oswald Chambers once said, make it Make it your habit to have no habits. Make it your habit to have no habits. If you find that it's going to be a habit, then stop it. Where were we free and now someone has enslaved us? If we look at Galatians, I didn't write it down, I didn't have it up here, but if you just read the book of Galatians chapter 5, you'll find that it talks about not being enslaved again, not being enslaved to that which you've been set free from. Well, how does it work? Well, ask a compulsive gambler how it works. Ask an addict how it works. Ask yourself, what has you? What draws you away from Yehovah? What draws you away from the Kehillah? What draws you away from your family? It doesn't have to be evil. It doesn't have to be evil. It can just be something that you need to have more than something else. More than God. So sin enslaves. And it does it in three ways. Are you ready for them? I hope you get them. Number one, it's sin enslaves to itself. Which means it leads to more sin and worse sins, and each one entrapping and more binding than the last one. Look at this picture. Then it wants you to look at the magazine. Then it wants you to look at the website. Then it wants you to look at a greater website. You understand what I'm saying? Have a little of this drink, and then you'll have a little bit more drink, and have a little harder drink, and just have a little puff of this, and that turns into a little puff of that, and it just increases. Sin enslaves to itself. It enlarges itself in you. Who needs to know this? We do. Who needs to know this? Our children do. Because they have a hope that if we were stuck in slavery, then you fight for them not to have it. Right? You understand it. You get it. You're driven by it. And you still fight with it in your own life, whether it's a food or a TV or a drink or a drug or a nicotine or whatever it is, whatever drives you, whether it's this or that or whatever it is, you know it when you go home and carefully look and consider your life. Number two, sin enslaves to flesh. When we habitually sin, that's when addictions are created and bodily cravings come alive with a vengeance. See, sin not only enlarges itself, but it then attaches itself to you in your flesh, and your flesh once experienced it once more. Your flesh runs amok. How many's ever had your flesh run amok? Let me just put it very simply. How many has ever said something, meant to stop saying something, and could not stop yourself from saying something? Because you said to yourself, I just got to say it. Well, that means you cannot control your flesh. That means in that area of your life, that means that's how the flesh does. Once it gets you to taste it, We know, and I'm saying that about our young people with the, you know, with the phone. It's altering their brain. It's creating and remapping their brain. It's giving some people a horn back there, if you ever read about it. Some of you already started with horns, so I don't know if you need an extra horn. Harmful mental habits are formed, and destructive patterns of living are birthed. That's why the Bible says, and just be very simple, it's not good for a man to touch a woman, because what happens after you touch a woman? You want to touch her more? And you want to touch her in places that are inappropriate? Come on. Which leads to something else, and leads to something else. And once you have led to that, then what do you want? Drug addicts now need another fix. Kleptomaniacs need to steal again. gluttons need to eat. And what happens when we don't eat? We get frail. We're talking one hour from eating. I'm frail. I get headaches. Oh, man, I got such a headache. I need to eat. What, you know what the headache means? Your flesh saying, you haven't fed me a bag of chips for at least 45 minutes. I want more chips. Get a dozen donuts. See if you can eat just one. If that's your, you know, something. Well, I don't eat them. I know, but you lick the sugar off of it, which is the same thing. But once you're free, each one doesn't need to be a slave anymore. So the first way that sin enslaves, that it enslaves to itself. And the second way, it enslaves to flesh. And let me tell you, flesh is hard to break. I know I'm talking to some very great, powerful spiritual people. And I'm just one of those, you know, preaching guys who struggle. Flesh is hard. If you like to go to bed late, try to go to bed early and see what your flesh says. You like to go get up early? You like to get up late and try to get up early? See what your flesh, how does your flesh respond? It needs something. It will fight you. It will throw that that little thing that's beeping across the room. Pound it. Number three, which is the worst of all, and I don't think we get it. Sin enslaves to demons. Oh, Lord is right. See, demon spirits inspired Nazi officers to throw babies into fire to save bullets. That's demonic. See, demon spirits help to move horrific crimes. If you're raping and murdering someone, that's not just flesh, that's demonic. If you're abusing a child and doing some horrific things to a child, that's demonic. That is beyond our human flesh. And what that means is it could have started simply by just allowing sin to be introduced, and then it enslaved to itself, and then it enslaved to flesh. And once it did that, it has the power to enslave to demonic powers. Demon spirits is one who abuses a child to commit heinous acts. That's not human. Demons are at the center of everything, ugly and destructive. And yes, when you give yourself to sin, you give yourself to them. And here we sit as religious people. And if it wasn't for the grace of Yehovah, or a message like this that might want us to stop and think, to consider our lives, to go back and say, yeah, I was free. Why in the world do I want to be bound? And what happens is when you are now enslaved, not only to itself, enslaved, then also to flesh, and now you are enslaved to demons. Demons harass you. Demons intimidate you. Demons beckon you. Demons move you. Demons dominate you. You got to, you have to, you're pushed to, you must do it, you have to. your body, your flesh, your spirit, your mind responds to it. And without it, it feels like you're dying. Remember the demons that used to flee from you? Now they torment you, incite you. Now you heed their voice when they say, go ahead, turn it on, go ahead, take a drink, go ahead, take a puff, go ahead, turn it on. That's crazy. Okay. I'm crazy, but I'm crazy telling you the truth. Because if you think I'm crazy, that means you have something in your life that needs to be taken care of, and I'm getting close to the edge of getting you to understand you have a problem. Some of us find ourselves in dire straits. We're captive, we're a slave, we're a prisoner, because sin has enslaved us, and it seems as if Yehovah is far away. But Yeshua is the Son of God, and he's never left us nor has ever forsaken us. What sin could possibly be worth committing if the price you pay is slavery? Think about it. I don't think any African American would say, I'd like to go back to 40 years ago and experience slavery. I don't think any Jew wants to go back and experience the Holocaust. Right? I don't think any group of people that have been bound or enslaved or have gone through horrific things want to go back. But then we have to ask ourselves, were we not bound before we come to know Yeshua? And now that we are free, why would we want to go back? Why would we want to be a slave to sin or a slave to flesh? And certainly, why would we want to be a slave to demons or even the devil himself? So the prophet was wise in Haggai. And what did the prophet say? Think about your life. Consider your ways. We'll read again in Haggai chapter 1, verses 5 through 7. Therefore, here is what Adonai Sevaot says. Think about your life. And he says this, he describes it. You sow much but bring in little. You eat but aren't satisfied. Right? You drink but never have enough. You clothe yourselves but no one's warm. And he who works for a living earns wages that are put in a bag full of holes. Right? Here is what Adonai Sevaot says. Think about your life. Consider your ways. Look at your life. Look what you could have and look what you don't have. Look what you have and yet not having. Right? Consider your ways. Don't worry about them. Just worry about me. They're trying to give you heat. I'm trying to give you out of heat. I'm trying to bring you to a place of refreshing. So what do we have to do? What is Haggai trying to tell us to do? He's trying to tell us to stop. Don't start something that is going to enslave you to itself, enslave you to your flesh, and enslave you to demons. Don't do it. Just stop. Tell our young people, don't even begin. You might say, well, I tried it and I was okay. Yeah, but it's a different day, a different age, a different demon, a different devil. I know we say it's the same, but there's something different about this society. There's something different that is about what is going on today. The lawlessness of this day, the demonic anti-spirit has increase. You had it at a level 4. They have it at a level 9, which means they will be possessed and consumed and oppressed, and the devil will kill them and steal from them and destroy them. And when will you learn? I don't care if you gave birth to them. They are different than you. They will be different than you. They are different than you. We need not to start something we cannot stop. Therefore, we must train our children and guard them. Well, they've got to learn to live. Then let them learn to live when they're older. My Father, help us all. Our children are growing up too fast. 12, 13, what was I doing? I was still riding the bike, jumping off ramps, trying to kill myself. Come on. I was out in the neighborhood playing football with the neighborhood kids. We didn't think of anything else other than tackle. But our children are being opened to something that will bind them and will be hard to get rid of. For the simple reason, it's hard for us to get rid of our little ones. Temptation is real. Turn to someone and say it. Temptation is real. You're free now. Don't get enslaved. Walk away before shame overtakes you. Because sin brings shame. We have to walk away and ask Yahweh to cleanse our minds. Right? Listen, you're walking through Walmart, you're walking through Food Lion, you're walking or driving, and something comes into your brain, and you know it's a, you know it's the enemy just trying to get you to have that sin in itself and sin enslaved to flesh. And what you need to do, if you have to, just pull over and start cleansing your mind. Turn the music on. Turn the worship on. Turn the praise on. Fill yourself with holy thoughts. Run! Fill yourself with worship and the word. When that which is opposite comes against you, run! Run to him, worship him, praise him. Don't lose your spouse or your children or your family or your relationship or your sanity or your job. Don't lose your freedom for something that just wants to enslave you. We have to understand that we can't cross over the line. We can't. You have to learn to run the other way. There's nothing wrong with running the other way. If you're not strong enough, run the other way. Listen, if you end up being around people and they want to offer you something and you don't, run the other way. They'll yell at you. They'll make fun of you. That's okay. Run. Run the other way. Because sin enslaves. Sin enslaves itself. Sin enslaves flesh. And sin enslaves demons. Break the cycle while you have the power and don't listen to the devil's lies. I'm giving you the moment where you can break the cycle, the moment where you consider your life, the moment when you think about your life and start right now to say, that's an area of my life. I'm going to break that thing. That's an area of my life. I'm going to break that thing. And I know that if you might have more than one or two or five, then pick one. Break it and then move to the next one and break that one and move to the next one and break that one till you finally get back to the freedom that God has given you. Who the Son has set free is free indeed. He is the Son of God. I have come to give you life and to give it to you more abundantly, which means then Satan has only your destruction in mind. He's plotting to bring you down. He's plotting to bring your children down. He's plotting to bring your grandchildren down. And we have to consider our ways. We have to think about our lives. We have to understand that we only live for such a very short time. And we have to learn to guard ourselves and guard our children and guard our grandchildren and guard our lives and put Yahweh first. And if we're going to be addicted, let's be addicted to him. If we're going to be enslaved, then let us be enslaved to him. If we can't do without something, let us not do without him. Let that drive us. It's snowing, it's sleeting, it's hailing, it's dark, but I got to get to the house of God. I need to get my praise on. Yeah, but you bring me out in danger. You'll go out in danger for a pack. You'll go out for something. Remember years ago, we snowing, sleeting. One of my members call, can your kids go? Where are you going? We're going to the mall. What do you mean you're going to the mall? Now, I happen to know that these people wouldn't come to the church if it was snowing, but they want to pack a car from here to South Park to go to the mall in winter weather. Well, we just stuck in here. We don't want to be stuck in. I wish you'd say that when it was church time. I don't want to be stuck in here. I need to get to the house of the Lord. That's the only bad thing about the internet, and I'm glad that people watch on the internet. That's the only thing bad, because you're not compelled. Oh, I can just stay home and watch it. And that's nice that we can have people that, you know, when you're home to watch it, that's great. But here's the thing. If it stops you, I mean, like 3 years from now, I just watch it. You're missing something. You're missing the point. The point is not just watching. The point is interacting. Feeling, coming, family, that's the point. when you're sick, when you're home, yes, praise the Lord that we've come to that place. When I'm in Africa, I can watch you. Keep my eye on you. And I appreciate that technology, but don't let that technology stop you. Don't put your praise music on so they praise for you. Put your praise music on and praise with them. There's something powerful when you minister to him instead of him ministering to you all the time. There's a release that happens. The devil is plotting to bring you down. He's plotting. And so what does Haggai say? He gives us the greatest instruction. He says, stop. Consider your life. Think about your life. We have to stop and ask ourselves the question, which way are we going? Are your standards higher today than they were in the past, or have they gradually become lower? Consider your life. What you allow today that you didn't allow 20 years ago. We use, oh, I'm growing. No, if you're growing to become more unholy, then that's not growing. Can I tell you what that's called? Backsliding. That's not growing. Is your ability to resist temptation stronger now, or do you find yourself slipping, yielding more easily? Are you doing things now habitually or with little sense of conviction or guilt that you would never have gone near in the past? Remember when you stole a piece of candy, you couldn't hardly stand it. You just were like collapsed. If your mother and father looked at you, you just collapsed. You just knew they knew. You just knew that someone told on you. I don't care whether you got rid of the evidence or not. So they just look at it, where you at? Where were you been? Where were you at? I didn't mean to steal it. I'm just asking you where you were. Today, they can look right at you. I didn't do it. What's this wrapper in your pocket? I don't know. Well, who put it in there if you didn't do it? I don't know. Probably was there when you bought the pants. Right? You can't even, there's no guilt nor conviction. You know why there's no guilt nor conviction? Because we haven't told them what sin is. Well, they were probably hungry. I don't care if they were hungry. You don't steal it. So what's Haggai say? Consider your ways. Think about your life. Number five, told you I spend more time on the enslaved than this one, but this one's important. Sin degrades and humiliates. Everything changes. A reputation is ruined, and you now look at that person differently, and I don't care how much you say it's okay, you look at that person differently. If they never stole and all of a sudden they never stole in 20 years and now all of a sudden they got caught stealing something, you know the next time you leave your pocketbook or your wallet where you used to leave it, you don't leave it anymore. You're like, I just like to keep my pocketbook where I... That person's reputation is ruined and it takes quite a long time. They have been polluted and stained. And I know that God wipes away stains. And I know that God covers. And I know that God changes. And I know, but I'm just telling you, the initial response. And it takes a while. All your great accomplishments become compromised in just one moment. One choice. Lives become tainted. Achievements are marred. And the shameful reproach is never worth the sinful release. Because that's all that sin is a moment of release. Ecclesiastes 10:1, the preacher says, how many want to listen to a preacher? Here's what he says. Just as dead flies make perfumed oil stink, so a little folly outweighs wisdom and honor. There ain't none of you with your perfume. Put a little dead fly in it. I think that adds a little something to it. No. I mean, we haven't read these scriptures. I mean, this is powerful scriptures, right? Proverbs chapter 6, 32 and 33. Solomon says it this way. He who commits adultery lacks sense. He who does it destroys himself. He will get nothing but blows and contempt, and his disgrace will not be wiped away. So we have to be wise now and do what? Consider your ways. Teach our children to consider their ways, to think about their life. You know, ask Samson if his sexual fling was worth it. Ask a disgraced pastor who lost everything. Ask a pregnant teenager after Mr. Wonderful has left. Sometimes it works out, sometimes it doesn't. You want to take really the chance. Sin, what does it do? It degrades. It humiliates by what it does to you and by how it makes you feel. Look at it this way. Satan loves to mock the human race. Do you know why? Because we were made in the image of God. And if he can destroy that image in any of us, he smiles with the biggest smile he can ever have. He loves to see Jehovah's creation putting needles in their arms, shouting and stabbing each other, begging for another drink, dying with disease, full of guilt and shame, drowning in embarrassment. He enjoys it. And our King and our Savior wept over it and died that we might be free. The devil loves to humiliate us. We wouldn't stand for it. Someone humiliated your child. Someone humiliated you. You'd want to stand and take a stand against it, right? Don't talk to my child that way. Don't talk to me that way. That's humiliating me. But yet we allow the devil to do it. Again, ask Samson. Who was Samson? A mighty deliverer. Do you know that he was the most supernaturally announced or anointed man in scriptures? Do you realize that the most greatest deliverer, the most supernatural anointed man, ends up shackled in bronze fetters, eyes gouged out, grinding at a prison mill, the laughing stock of all the enemies of Yahuwah? The enemies of Yahuwah that he was created to undo and destroy. Yeshua has come to set us free and to destroy the works of the enemy. And then when we get entangled again, and what brought him down? Lust. Let's just say lust, not a woman, but lust. I know you all get mad. A woman. Why are you always attacking a woman? The lust. It just happened to be the lust of a woman. Let me ask you this question before Robin puts it up. Does anyone know the first word Samson ever spoke in the Bible? Does anyone know it? The first words. And you know, first words are important, right? I mean, don't you just wait for your child to say, Dada? No, Dada. Dada. I mean, when the grandchildren were born, I spent most of my time saying, Pap, 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 pap. So it wasn't a hard thing when they started saying, Pap, pap. I was like, see? Because every time I was with them, I was like, Pap, 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 pap. Well, let's look at Judges chapter 14. Here's the first words. He came up, told his father and mother, I saw a woman in Tamah, one of the Philistines. What's he say? Now get her for me. That's the first words out of Samson's mouth that we find in Judges. Isn't it interesting that God would record that's the first words of Samson, and then we would have a clue of where his fall would come? Listen to your words. The devil delights in turning our existence on this earth into a living hell. But I got some news for you. Yeshua is the Son of Yehovah, and he who sets you free will let you be free indeed. Yeshua loves to shower us with glory and honor. He not only redeems our lives from the pit, but he crowns us with love and compassion. Look what Psalms 103:4. He redeems your life from the pit. He surrounds you with grace and compassion. Someone should give God some praise right now. He redeemed you from the pit. He has caused your slavery to no longer exist. Someone came to liberate you. He washes us with his blood, frees us from our sins, makes us a kingdom of priests to serve God and the Father. Look what it says. The next verse. Coming, I sense it. Revelation 1:5-6, and from Yeshua the Messiah, the faithful witness, the firstborn from the dead, and the ruler of earth's kings, to him, the one who loves us, who has freed us from our sins at the cost of his blood, who has caused us to be a kingdom that is co-redeemed for God his Father, to him be the glory and rulership forever and ever and ever and ever and ever and ever and ever. Amen. Look who you are now. He takes us into his family, and he's not ashamed to call us brothers and sisters. Hebrews chapter 2. For both Yeshua, who sets people apart for God, and the ones being set apart have a common origin. That is why he is not ashamed to call them brothers. You sit here, and he's not ashamed of you. Yes, he might be upset at times when you begin to get entangled again when he has set you free. Yes, he's upset when the enemy looks at him and says, see, you set them free and I bound them again. But now's the time for us to consider our ways, to think about our lives. That is what our Savior does. Our Savior upgrades, not degrades our lives. You can't go anywhere but up. You hear me? Everybody wants an upgrade. As I get older, I look in the mirror and say, I need an upgrade. I don't know how to do it. It costs too much money. I don't want my eyes back here at the end of the day, so sometimes just let it alone, just let it alone. But you know, you recognize that I need a little upgrade. I need something. So the older you get, you never bend over, talk to people. You always talk like this. How you doing? Makes everything fall back. How you doing? Are you pious? No, I'm just getting an upgrade. Claw, you know, nice creams. You get creams, right? Moisturizer. Hallelujah. If all else fails, nice little sweater, nice little scarf wrapped around up to here. Upgrade. Look at Isaiah. He needs an upgrade. You're so sweet. You're so sweet. You're so very sweet. I wasn't talking about
Gee, he has Bethany now. He doesn't need an upgrade.
D, consider your ways. So look, the next time you're tempted to sin, think of the Savior instead. And as you submit to Yehovah and resist the enemy, you have a friend who will be there to fortify you and to help you stand. Turn to someone and say, it's time. for me to consider my ways. I have to think about my life because I refuse to be enslaved. He has set me free, and I am free indeed. Stand before the Lord. Give the Lord a shout of freedom. Shout because you're free. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. Hug someone and tell them, I'm with you. Hallelujah. Come on, children. Hey. Oh, I forgot. I had a little brain fade. Looking for the prayer shawl. It's right there. Ooh, glory. Now, you know what Dee did? Now, every man has to go to their wife and say, you are my upgrade. You are my upgrade. Woo! Father, we thank you and we praise you for this day, this Sabbath day that you've given to us. What a blessing it is, Father. Lord, we consider our ways. We think about our lives, Father, Lord, to become, Lord, more conformed to you, to be, Father, more holy than we are. Father, not by anything that we can do, but by the Son, by the blood, by the Spirit of God that lives within us. Father, Lord, bless these children. Father, Lord, let them, even at an early age, consider the ways, protect them, Father. Let us also, Father, understand the responsibility of protecting them. Father, let them walk in your ways, be empowered by your Spirit. Father, Lord, do great and mighty things for you. And Father, Lord, we ask for the blessing of the Spirit of God to be rest upon them, and we'll give you praise in Yeshua's name. Amen and amen. Lift up your hands to receive the priestly blessing today. Hallelujah. He is good.
Yevarechecha Yehovah ve'yishmere. Yahovah Panav Alecha Vichunecha Yisrael.
Yehovah, he who exists, now before you presenting gifts and will guard you with a hedge of protection. And Yehovah, he who exists, will illuminate the wholeness of his being toward you, bringing order. He will provide you with love, sustenance, and friendship. And Yehovah, he who exists, will lift up wholeness of being, look upon you. He will set in place all you need to be. whole and complete. May Yehovah grant all the desires of our hearts, fulfill all our purposes and all our petitions. May Yehovah hear from heaven, quickly answer all our requests. Save us in the day of adversity. In the name of Yeshua the Messiah, defend us from our enemies, from poverty, and from bondage. Shabbat shalom. Shabbat shalom. See you in the Oneg.
Make it count, leave a mark, build a name for yourself. Dream your dreams, chase your heart above all else. Make a name the world remembers. But all an empty world can sell is empty dreams. I got lost in the lie that it was up to me to make a name.